So, that'll be fun, and it'll be interesting too. And we have our worship set to start us off.
We're going to go to the scene, part of it is good moment of the rock that we stand on. The second part is that we want to put into action what we ask that we do. And you'll see a couple of songs coming to music that, in particular, my favorite is pretty arbitrary, the light song. So, I don't know.
send your spirit now to us, that we may engage in time of prayer, that we will find sister, that was in her apartment for that fire start a couple weeks ago. And now she's got another apartment, she's all sitting in the back of the and we'll remember her. Everybody that told her that time to find a new place to live. It's pretty good. Yay! Inspire people to come up with this ministry and perception of how brilliant and gifted artists are going to be singing and playing at the top of their skill level about the wonder that you came among us, that you were born among us, so we didn't know you, and that you went through death for us, that we might know you and be free of our sin. So, for this afternoon, this wonderful celebration, we thank you in advance. We thank you, Lord, for share of her healing as it's coming along. For this word that she can return to her home after the middle of February. I thank you for all the caring people who does such a great job with her therapy. And we pray that she'll be able to have a trait removed from her throat before she goes home. Lord, we give you thanks for Lisa and her chance to be with so many people now and witnessing to them and just being with them, being their friend in these classes and that you have acted to take her out of isolation and into community. Thank you. Pray for the David C. group of 4B and G. Thank you for coming here so that we can sing with them your praises of bold, great old times. And that you're opening the door for them to minister throughout Western Massachusetts and maybe adding them into the Western Union. Praise your holy name. It's a lot, isn't it? No, the miserable. Just a minute. There is an old time thing. If the God's name was, I am the great I was. But he's not the great I was. He's the great I am. And he's blessing me to find out he can do this for now. Yeah. Now, how about needs that we should be praying for? Father, we pray that we're mindful of how cold it is and how many people are struggling to have heat. And so we pray, first of all, for some warmth and then for shelter. family of Bruce Watson. And it will validate the support of their friends, the compassion. And then we pray also for our women, that our President Barack is ready to deliver this state of the union. We pray for all of you who are considering themselves as leaders this year, that they will get a good feeling and a good decision in the union. Pray for a very violent return of all we've seen in Ukraine and Egypt, and all the stress of trying to have a just society for eternity. This is way beyond this. And then we'll have prayer for the other churches who are praying for us, these vitality ministry, we pray for every church in Thomas in Connecticut, we pray also in Fairfax for Nashua, New Hampshire, we pray for Fairfax, and the Covenant Church in Springfield, we pray for us, that they, like we, will go through this together and emerge as vibrant communities for your glory and for ministering to their communities and for the spread of the gospel. Thank you. needs this, to you, and your kingdom, to offer them to you, because we're thankful for all that you must have been to us. Our friends, our families, our land, our country, our church, we all come to you. So have a look, we get the time to do this in here. You will be secure. Your name and your hope and your love and your life before you. Thank you for being on this. Especially the Hebrew portion of it, without the money. Great big book in the middle of it. which has this amazing restatement of the whole of the Torah and a lot of stories of Moses that had just been lost. So they showed him, said, this is primitive. Look, we found it. Here it is. So he read it. Then he had it read to all the people. And then he said, this is sacred. This is the part of the thing we've been missing. This is what we're going to do. And the people said, okay. If they hadn't been to that, we would be missing. And they said, yeah, we need to perform it. As Jesus ends his great sermon, he picks up this same thing, that the words he has been teaching us are to be performed, that he does it. The words of the Lord are not just to be one. Compared to other religious teachings, doesn't matter if you highlight them in yellow or put them in red. He's not worried about our theories about the universe and all that. What it is he loves us, and he's telling us the way to eternal life. Indeed, he's describing the ways of eternal life that is in case right now. So I'm going to finish this preaching series by looking at this last paragraph. And I invite you to do a reading. It's in the red. And then we'll go ahead. Let's read the red together and then I'll see what the reading is like. This is how Jesus ends his sermon. Never hear that in the circumstances like you. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the wind blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the wind blew, and it beat into that house, and it fell with a great crash on it. When Jesus had finished these things, the crowd was amazed at his teaching, because he taught as one of them had before. If you been in a sermon like that, in a homiletics course, or a sermon course, preaching course, suddenly they bail you right out. I want to look at the differences between the wise and the foolish man. And it also depends on that. The word foolish is kind of polite. You know, we're always kind of making the scriptures a little more Victorian and proper than they actually are. The word is morals, from which we get our word moron. If you listen to this, then don't do it. You're a moron! Okay. Yikes. Then what I want to consider, after we look at the description of wise men and the foolish men, is I want to think about what it means to do it, to enact what Jesus said. And then I want us to remember about the authority of the one who has been my nature. religious ones in Jesus' concluding parable are very superficially alike. They both are building a house, probably both building a house out of the same kind of material. They have families, they want to build a nice house for their family. You know, they all get along and they have bedrooms and stuff. The foolish one builds on sand. And the way the Greek works here, the way the story works, the image is, I think, of putting sand in a dry wadi, or in Texas they call them arroyos. Because in real Arab climates, there are former riverbeds and former river plains that are now just dry. So there's a great escape. Because even in very dry climates, every once in a while it rains. And sometimes it rains a lot. And when a lot of rain comes in Israel or Texas or places like that, you get these huge floods because the ground is hard and the old riverbeds, you know, are usually sort of canyon things, and you get a ton of water going through there during its way at the end of the year. Right. So, within this story, the wise man finds rock on which to build. So the difference between the wise and the foolish is the difference in thinking about the long term. Because at first, they both think about the same. And if nothing changed, then what would they do? But a wise person thinks about the long term and thinks about foundational things, things that you don't see exactly, but that are underneath. Things that you don't need and then you need them and then you need them if you don't have them. Right? What is foundational, therefore, that we need to think about in our lives? What's deep and strong? The questions that wise people will think through are these. What am I here for? Where am I headed? What's the point of my existence? When the storm comes, when death threatens, what will I stand on? What do I stand for? You know, it's perfectly easy and possible to get by without attending to these things in this moment. You can always say, well, I'll work that out later. I remember my family said, well, I'm going to, you know, look at religion when I retire. Kind of work. Because we can pile up money and so on. And we can live so that we look about as successful as most folks. Not that's what we've done. But to live like that, to live without purpose, to live without the hope of eternal life, you know, John Wesley said, I am like an arrow shot out of a bow. I am intent on heaven. There's a machine stuff. if you're not on social media, you're not on YouTube, you're not on Facebook, you're not on that, like, you know, I mean, it's like, oh man! It's just, like, great to me. It's so distracting, right? So, you can make it through so you go back to sleep. Now, at night, is that, but, like, you need to do it. Is what won't be washed away. That even God, the eternal salvation, yes. But in this story concerning Jesus, it acts up in a little different. He says, the one who hears his words and does not do them is one who will always be worried about this world. And someone whose house will get swept away. Someone who hears his words and does them, and they are very improbable words, as you'll remember if you're going through that sermon now. They don't sound like they don't work. But if you hear them and do them, then suddenly the truth of God is demonstrated to you, and your faith shoots up, and you can weather all storms, even death, and be secure. Tuesday night, when I took my four dogs to help them do their business. They usually like that, but that makes their business. When we came back in, I decided to leave with them instead of sleeping. And the father's sister had given us these things I've never seen before called sheets. Oil. And so we had those on. I said, "Don't do that." And we let those two great groups get through. And we listened. And you know, I was looking to the window. We listened to the wind moaning outside, and the house creaking. And we just snuggled. Oh yeah, that's what we want. That's what we're talking about. Security. Yeah. How do we get there? Jesus tells us is when we do what he says. It's not just when we hear them and oh, what a wonderful someone is like to deal with. No. It's when we do what he says. It's when we stop living the way the ads tell us. If we are practicing the words of Jesus that are in the Sermon on the Mount, then, you know, practicing his words affects who we are. We'll have a positive spirit. I mean, we will not think of ourselves as sort of this God-like sky around which other planets orbit. We will mourn for our sins. We will be humble. We will want to be righteous. We will be known as a merciful and merciful God. Talk to him about it. Talk to him about mercy. Show him mercy. We will be known as peacemakers. We will be known as pure hearted. And as rejoicing when our faith is attacked. That's what she says. Remember all the blessings, whether it's Christian or something. That's the sermon on the mount. It means we will live as salt of the earth and as bright lights of hope. It means we'll be reconciled with all our fellow believers and we will become affirmers of everyone's dignity, even the ones that people despise. It means we will have a ruthless control of lust It means we'll live with integrity. It means we'll turn the other cheek when we're insulted. It means we will love our enemies. I hope he's breathing on the curve. Aren't you? But wait, there's more. If we are practicing his words, just the words here in the Sermon on the Mount, then that will be evident in our secret life of giving to the needy, praying, fasting, forgiving everyone who has hurt us. Remember that big long section of the Sermon on the Mount? That means forgiving, you know, our exes. My dysfunctional family of origin. It lays down a little. That's all for it. It will show up in our investments into the kingdom of heaven. Going to tithe and beyond for the sake of the gospel. It will show in our relationships. In the fact that we judge no one and people trust us not to judge them. It will be known in the fact that we seek God with all our hearts. That we treat others the way we want to be treated. And finally, we will sense that we went through another assault of an assault on our ego for the sake of God. And that we're building our lives on the rock. That's what we've done. I don't know about you, but I can just understand that. And there it is. to get a Savior. And if this Sermon on the Mount is a standard for life, then what we need, big time, is a Savior. And through Him we get the Holy Spirit, which is the joy and the fizz of life with Him, along with gifts and guidance. We get each other. You know, we're all in this place. None of us is doing it perfectly. If you're a perfect person, you can be not long in this place. When I started the church, I knew I wouldn't have any pretensions for perfection because I was always given. I think perfection is itself is a tendency. We're just not moving on. We're all just a mix. We need each other's help. We don't need each other's judgment. And we need Christ of God, which is for us, not on the street. And we have it. All right. Whenever we say to God, okay, I'll turn it your way, but oh God, I need help, I need help. That's when he does kingdom business. And that's when we get the God's real. Like, they doesn't say so in the book of Exodus, but I'm sure, pretty sure, this is how the actual Exodus works. They're trapped. They're all these extremely angry Egyptians. Come back down. There's this big water. And there's a very upset Egyptian prisoner. And Moses standing in the middle of the room. I know they find that she got me too. And God says, take the staff and hold it there. You can talk a while. Why not let them know? Not a big deal. Moving water. And I think the Lord stays first. And Moses said, God is turning the water. Everybody charge forward. And I don't think it can happen until the most reckless teenager, God's favorite people, cool. And I stepped in there. And I think when that first human stepped in, boom, the water. That's how it's like this turning around. And nobody was for a long time, but I didn't doubt it. And then one day, I and I can't tell you what was it. I am not going to go. But it came from death and came from God. And once you see it, and once somebody has actually experienced it, like the way it goes right up to the ceiling. The whole Sermon on the Mount answers the question, how then shall we live? And the answer is so challenging. This is how it is. This is this vision of the kingdom of God life, which is the great thing, Sermon on the Mount. It's so challenging that, of course, the next question that logical arises in our mind says, ooh. Says, on whose authority is this crazy, wonderful life of an enemy? Well, it's the preacher. Not the preacher, this preacher. The preacher. That one. It says they were astonished by his authority, just dumbfounded, because he didn't quote the Bible. Like I do. He didn't quote earlier experts. Like I do. He didn't even, like the great prophet, say, thus says the Lord. Instead, Jesus said, you have heard that it was said of old, but I say to you. He claims, he with his help, when we're not capable of living this life, can we ask him? But with him helping us, we can enter and explore the life of the kingdom of God, which is what this whole sermon is going about. Knowing that he will raise us even as he himself has been raised. We could never do this on our own. Thank God we do not need to. So I think we thank him. Because in his company, our inadequacies are overcome, his high calling becomes possible, and ultimate security opens before us. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for inside all guidance and all the visions that are in this word from the end to end. There is a sermon about summing it all up, challenging us. And I thank you most of all, Father, that you sent Jesus to us, both to teach us and to walk alongside us, helping us, filling us with your Holy Spirit, that this astonishing vision of life outside of distraction, life in your kingdom, is open to us. Jesus, stay by my side and stay with all my friends. This will embrace this vision of a holy life. And pray.